nearby.
Good afternoon, everybody, and welcome to your afternoon safari here in the northeast corner of magnificent South Africa. We are in the Greater Kruger National Park. Of course, South Africa is the world's most beautiful country, from Cape Town, where all the hipsters live, all the way up to Musina on the border of Great Zimbabwe. It is the most wonderful country. And if you have not had the pleasure of coming to visit us, I do hope that one day you will be able to enjoy the wonders of beautiful South Africa. And you see how I nearly said magnificent there twice, but then I changed myself and said beautiful, Viam, and I said beautiful. That was very clever of me. It wasn't, of course. My name is James Henry. On camera today is Viam. Hello, Viam. There we go. Viam is slightly more cheerful than he was this morning, but that is a very marginal state of affairs. You are on a very live safari, and we're driving through Arethusa at the moment. That is about 850 hectares of land that we traverse on the western edge of our traversing, and it in turn is on the western edge of the northern Sabi Sand, a collection of private game reserves tacked on to the Kruger National Park. You're most welcome. Please do talk to us over the next 3 hours. Hashtag Safari Live or questions at wildearth.tv if you're on the email. On the other vehicle, we have two vehicles out today. Byron, the Portugal Serrao, is on his way to Cheetah Plains. He is going to the east. He is from the south of Johannesburg. Don't hold that against him. And he is being filmed by the ultimately elegant figure of Brian Joubert. In the final control, Kirsten McLennan-Smith with her flaming red hair and being ably assisted by Louise Pavide and her large guns. We are hopefully going to see, well, we don't know what's around at the moment, so there were no cats seen this morning, so we're in kind of the dark, or if you like, we're in a state of excited mystery, because we don't know what's going to be around the next corner. It's a very balmy day. I think it's about 25 degrees Celsius, which puts us at about, it was 27 degrees Celsius, which puts us at 80 degrees Fahrenheit. That's not bad for midwinter, I don't think. And it's been a lovely, lovely winter's day here. Cold in the morning, deep blue winter skies, and I think we're in for a lovely afternoon. Whether that lovely afternoon will include any animals, well, if current form has anything to do with it, it won't. But with any luck, our luck is about to change. Ah, it is. Our luck has changed already, Viam. Do you see what I see? It is a hippopotamus, everyone. A hippopotamus in Red Dam. That is this quarry that we are sitting at now, here at Arethusa. And it is some of the last remaining water. And hippopotami like this one here, of course, are wandering between the last remaining bits of water. Normally young bulls, suboptimal habitat. And they're looking for nice places to lie up while the water is sort of diminished. They will eventually, I suppose, have to head down towards the rivers, the Sand River to the south, and which will probably flow. I wonder if it is still flowing, actually. There'll be some pools left there, and then more permanent water, the Sabi River to the south of that. The hippos really are having a very tough time, and if you don't know about it, we had a severe drought during the summer. We're into the dry season now, and, you know, so it means it doesn't normally rain at this time of the year, but because we've had such a very bad drought during the wet season, there really isn't anything like the standing water that there would be at this time of the year. You can feel, perhaps, if you close your eyes and just imagine it and take a deep breath in, see if you can feel that really pleasant northwesterly breeze. It's coming straight over the top of that hippo, touching us slightly with the smell of the standing water. It's not an unpleasant smell at all, it's a very bush smell. Infused, of course, with the subtle scent of buffalo dung. And it is completely silent, but for that little bit of wind. Very few birds calling, the odd fly flying about my head. But otherwise, it's all rather quiet and rather peaceful and contemplative, I must say. A day like this, in the middle of the dry season, as the water's starting to dry up, it's definitely time for contemplation. This chap is definitely contemplating. Either that or he's asleep. What do you think, Viam? I'm talking about the hippopotamus, not the bird. The bird is, very well spotted there. That is a grey go-away bird, everybody, that Viam didn't want to tell me about. He chose instead to embarrass me by pointing the camera of it while I spoke about the hippo. Viam, we're going to have to do something about your attitude, I think. He's nodding. I wish you could see the impressive beard on his face. Before he goes on leave, we're definitely going to have to show it to you because it really is. It's quite something. He looks like a sort of hobbit slash yeti at the moment. I think the hippopotamus woke up at my description of Viam as a yeti. He's obviously afraid of yetis. Hello, TB Stain. A nice question from you, and it's an interesting one. You say, is it true that hippopotami have got pink milk? The answer is negative. They do not have pink milk. They do not have strawberry milkshakes for their little babies to drink. What they do have is a pink substance that comes out of the skin that makes their skin pink, and sometimes it can mix with the milk when the youngsters are suckling. But the milk is absolutely white. And I'm just looking quickly in a book that I have, simply because I think in this book it explained to me exactly how that works. But I don't see that at the moment. I'll keep having a check around and see if I can't find any sort of indication for why that, because it's a common thought and it's a common question. And it's a common, I think, misconception by many guides around the place. I'm sure they tell their guides that hippos have pink milk, and I don't think they do. In fact, I'm 900% sure that they don't. So I'll figure that one out, and I'll get back to you, TV Stain. Alrighty. Shall we move on from this hippopotamus, Viam? When the camera comes off the animal for the fourth time, that's Viam saying, press on, let's find something else. He does. Is that what? Something with teeth. That thing's got teeth. Nasty ones. He looks rather forlorn there, I must say. Oh well. He'll be okay, we hope. All right, let's head across to Byron Sarau and find out what has happening in the east at the Singapore noodle stand that is Cheetah Plains.
Good afternoon, everybody. Great to have you with us. James, thank you very much for that introduction. My name is Byron, and with me on camera this afternoon, we have Brian and the Thumb. Afternoon, Brian.
Afternoon.
Yes, James, I have just arrived on Cheetah Pools, and Brian and I are exploring this area a little bit. It's only my second time down here. So we are in search of any wildlife this afternoon. This morning, we were very fortunate. We had a lot of elephant activity around and some great sightings of young elephant. But we would like to see some cats this afternoon. So who knows, we will try. James was mocking me about being from the south of Johannesburg. But James doesn't have too much room to talk. He speaks as if he hails from the land of the English and from Cambridge perhaps, but he is just from Johannesburg, a little bit further north of where I am from. So I think we should mock James a little bit too. So while Brian and I are driving through here, we're scanning very carefully, having a look for any sign of wildlife that may have passed through here during the course of the day. Having a look if there's any water down. There's a little water hole or dam that is very, very dry at the moment. No water in there. You find in summer it probably fills up quite nicely with rainwater. You get a lot of animals will come down and drink in this area. As it starts to dry up, you get this beautiful mud wallow. And a lot of animals like elephant, rhino, buffalo. All those animals would come and wallow in the mud. It helps protect their skin, helps cool them down. You get warthog, a lot of animals. Oh, hang on, there we go. Giraffe. Have a look at this, everybody. Off to the right. Yay. Beautiful giraffe. A beautiful big male giraffe. Just enjoying a bit of the shade, and it looks like he is browsing off of that tree, which looks like it is a tambwati tree, which is very interesting. And I'll tell you why I find it interesting is because a tambwati tree is poisonous for us, but you do get other animals feeding on them, like the giraffe we can see, black rhino and kudu are some of the others which will feed on it. It's very interesting. It's a young tambwati tree. It's so nice to see this beautiful big male giraffe. You can see it does seem a little bit darker. See the beautiful pattern over his body. He is quite dark, and occasionally some of the older males or older giraffe do tend to become a bit darker. Their coloration does darken, but also just like our skin color all varies, the same happens with giraffe. Some giraffe are just genetically darker than others. If he sticks his head out again, I'd like to point out something very interesting. So, I mean, it's quite easy to tell from this angle that it is a male. If you look a little bit further down, you can see the male genitalia. But sometimes that is not clear. And another way to tell if it is a male or female, just from a distance, if he sticks his head out again, I will show you and point it out. But you can see the horns or the ossicles, they're just sticking out a little bit there. There we go, look at that. There you can see them. So those horns, or what are known as ossicles, the bone structure on the top of the head, they are completely bald. Do you see that? The males, their horns are very thick and they're bald on top. And the females have very thin horns with little black tufts on top. Their hair actually covers that horn, and you have these little black tufts. So if you just see the head of a giraffe, you can tell whether it is male or female very easily. He's really buried his head inside that tambwati tree. This is nice. I haven't seen giraffe for a few days. Nice surprise. Don't forget to send us your questions at #SafariLive on Twitter, or questions at wildearth.tv if you are emailing us questions. Have a look at the calcification around the male's head. Look on the back. You can see those two very prominent bumps, and on the forehead you can also see a very prominent bump, and that is all caused by calcification, a buildup of bone around the skull, and that is also a sign of age. This is a old giraffe, an old male, but he is still in very good condition, very big. And also the reason for a lot of that calcification buildup is when these males get a bit older, they do fight quite regularly with each other. Is what is known as necking. They'll stand next to one another and swing their necks around and hit each other with their heads. The reason for that is then for dominance and to try to chase the other male off so that that male may mate with the females. The long legs of a giraffe. See that tail swishing about, and that's just to try and keep away some of the flies and ticks which do sit on these animals. The wind has picked up quite a bit this afternoon. Brian and I fear there may be a front of sorts coming in, which could be interesting over the next few days. He seems to be a little camera shy, this giraffe. It's a beautiful afternoon, though. Despite the wind, the temperature is still very, very warm, and it's been a great day. This morning was much warmer than it was the previous two mornings, so we weren't as cold as we were the other two mornings. But the days, I mean, these afternoons, winter afternoons are beautiful. Really, really wonderful. Well, I think we've had a lovely view of this giraffe. He's really intent on feeding there for quite some time. Why don't we carry on and see what else we can find? As I mentioned, we're on Cheetah Plains this afternoon. So we are going to head towards those plains. They've got beautiful clearings. There's often a lot of animal activity around there. While I head into that area, cross over to James for an update.
Tell me when she links. What? Are we really live?
Yes.
Hello, everybody. That came faster than I thought. I must confess that I believe Byron won that little round of banter with his comment about my thinking I'm from Cambridge but actually being from Johannesburg. I don't really think that, of course, but it was very clever of him. Ha 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 ha. Now, this tree, everyone, is a jackalberry tree, and what I wanted to show you about it, there's a big hole back here, and one doesn't sort of stick one's hand in such holes in case there is a snook or snake having a snooze for the winter therein. I don't see any here. But this is the kind of tree, with a hole such as the one it has here, that a ground hornbill would like to sleep in. Now, I'm sure many of you have seen a ground hornbill. And ground hornbill, large turkey-like black bird with the red wattles about the throat, they need trees like this with enormous holes in the back, which I can't really show you, but there's an entrance like this to the hole. And there are it's the kind of tree that a ground hornbill can go into. But because trees like this seem to be fewer and further between, especially outside of protected areas, you find that the ground hornbills lack nesting sites that they used to once have. And it is one of the things that I think mistakenly conservationists are saying is one of the problems with having so many elephants around, is that trees like this are being knocked down. But in actual fact, if we had... In actual fact, if we had, I think I may have just pulled something there. Ooh, that's really painful. let me just take a minute. I think I injured myself yesterday. Right, there we are. Okay. In actual fact, if we had more protected areas outside of where elephants existed, I think you'd find that ground hornbills would survive just fine. Vim, there's a quite startling pain in between my arm and my chest, and I'm not entirely sure I'm going to be able to continue.
Alright, do you want to get some surgery?
Would you kindly cut my left arm off? I think it would be less painful.
Yeah.
I wish I was joking. We're going to go back to Byron briefly. Let me just sort myself out here.
So, James, I don't know what he's got himself into, but he's trying to climb trees again, it sounds like it. And you would have thought after yesterday's incident, he would have learned his lesson. But that's James for you. Still heading towards the clearings and the plains. Just past a small herd of or group of buffalo, but they were very deep into the bush. So Diva, it's your first time watching. Welcome to Safari Live. Great to have you with us. And it really is fantastic to be able to take everyone from all over the world who can log on and join us and take them through this wilderness that we are in at the moment. And what you see is completely live, which is very exciting. So there are no cuts. There's whatever happens, happens. If we make a mistake, you see it live. I understand you would like to see some hyena. We will definitely try and find some. We have got a hyena den on Juma at the moment, and they do move around, and every now and then we are lucky and we bump into them. So welcome, great to have you with us. This is only my first time on cheetah plains, only my second time on cheetah plains. So I'm still learning my way around a little bit, which is fun, it's exciting, it's exploring. I'm exploring this with you at the same time. Don't really know where I am at the moment, but that's the fun thing about this. Why don't we turn left here? A lot of elephant tracks around here. So Karen from London has asked, what is the species that is of grass which is known as elephant grass? Well, Karen, I'm not too sure. Well, there's that wind again that I was mentioning earlier. Beautiful water holes, very full at the moment. I don't see any sign of animals just yet. Let's just scan these bushes around here. And so, Karen, getting back to your question about the elephant grass, I'm not too sure of a common name of grass known as elephant grass. And one of the things about common names or colloquial names of trees or plant or grass material is that occasionally it may differ in certain areas. For example, we have a buffalo thorn tree, and in some areas it's known as a hakenstierk or a blinkblad wachebiki, which are Afrikaans or Dutch names. So the same tree with many different local names. Usually we try and refer to a scientific name, and that scientific name can't be changed. So it's easier to identify a species of tree or grass if we use a scientific name. I'm not too sure about elephant grass. Maybe James might have an answer for you a little bit later about that. He may have heard about it in his travels. I have not, so I'm not too sure about that one. Let's move on from this waterhole. Doesn't seem to be any activity here just yet. While I'm driving, also just having a close look for any tracks around this area. Maybe something has come to the waterhole to drink. Any predators, for example. As I said, there's been a lot of elephant activity there today. Can see all their tracks around. But I don't see any sign of predators just yet. Hornbill just took off right next to us. Beautiful hornbill, yellow-billed hornbill with that long beak, but just flew off. Just sitting right next to the road. We didn't see it. It was perched in a tree. So, Julian from Houston, you have asked us an interesting question. You have asked if ground hornbills close their nests like the other hornbill species do. So let me just quickly explain what the other hornbills do first. So the smaller hornbill species, the yellow-billed hornbill, red-billed hornbill, and the grey hornbill, what they do is they find a very prominent tree, quite a large tree. Let me see, there's one up ahead here. Let me see if I can find a little hole for you and explain it a bit better. This is a beautiful torchwood just next to us. So what would happen is, and let me get off here quickly and just show you. It's easier to explain while I'm showing you something. You still hear me there? You're all good. So if you have a look at the stem, this beautiful stem of this tree, you've got little gaps in this stem. Now, this is not a typical tree they would use. They would probably use something like a marula tree where there are little holes that they can get into. But what they do, for example, is they would find a hole. They would, the female would go inside. And what she does is she actually plucks her feathers. And those feathers she then uses as a nest. She will stay inside that hole. The male will come and fill that hole with mud, and he closes it up and he builds a little wall at the entrance and he leaves a very thin slit. Now what happens then is with that thin slit, the male will constantly fetch food for the female, and he returns to that nest every day feeding the female through that little hole while she lays the eggs and incubates the eggs inside there. Once the chicks are grown up and able to fly out of the nest, the female's feathers have then grown back and she breaks through that entrance and they all fly out together, which is incredible. So they are very reliant on that male for food, and because if not, or if he doesn't feed them, then they will obviously die. So it's an incredible relationship between that male, that female, and those chicks. The ground hornbills, however, are much, much larger. They are very, very big birds. They do nest in trees, though, but they build a proper nest that they will sit on. They do not nest the same way as those smaller hornbills do. So thank you for that question. I hope I've answered it correctly for you, or nicely for you, that you understand it a bit better. But it's an incredible bird. I mean, those hornbills, for them to have so much trust for that male, and for that male to constantly come back and feed the female, it's an incredible relationship. We are going to continue towards the plains of Cheetah Plains. While I do that, head back to James for an update.
Now, everybody, the reason I'm up this termite mound, of course, is because I thought that this bush from where you are sitting now looked rather leopardish. Clearly it is not a leopard, but it is an unusual species. It's called a dwarf bush cherry, and I believe it to be the first example of the tree that I found here. I'm now going to run down the termite mound back towards the car. You won't be able to hear me in the interim, but I'll show you the tree when I get there. Here we go. Can you hear me now, Viam? Right, there we are. Now, the dwarf bush cherry produces a little fruit that unfortunately doesn't taste anything like its name suggests it should. But there it is. And it's one of the few plants here, I guess, that has remained green so far over the winter, and I think it is an evergreen. That is the dwarf bush cherry, Merua parvifolia. Now, Byron, I believe, was talking to you about elephant grass, or somebody asked him a question about elephant grass. And elephant grass reminded me of a song by Johnny Clegg, in which he talks about the elephant grass. I've lost my earpiece there. There we are. Found it. Don't worry, everybody. Calm down. And I'm not sure. I think there are a number of different species of grass that are known as elephant grass, and one of them is Cymbopogon excavatus, or one of the Cymbopogon species, and sometimes some of the thatching grass species. But Kirsten reckons she's looked up, and it's probably something called Pennisetum. What was it? Pennisetum what? Purpurum. Pennisetum purpurum. Anyway, it's very long, kind of thatching grass, and it's called elephant grass because it's so very tall that you can't actually see through it. It'll be taller than a man. And I remember often when we were children, we used to go riding in the mountains in August, always in August, when the thatching grass was long and gold with a bit of red in it. And we'd go galloping along these mountain paths with the grass above our heads. And it was the most wonderful experience. And every time I hear the term elephant grass, I remember those incredible experiences of riding through the wilderness in the mountains on horseback. It is utterly irrelevant to our safari, but I thought I would tell you anyway. We're heading towards the Arethusa Dam now, hoping to find some thirsty animals coming down to drink. I've heard nothing on the radio yet as to anything going on this reserve. I think all the guests are just getting mobile. And if you ever come out to this place, and I think many of you have been out to, if not Arethusa, certainly some of the camps close by here, 3:30 or 3 o'clock, you make your way onto the deck. These glorious winter afternoons, and you have tea. This is only about an hour after you've had lunch, of course. Nice fat slice of delicious chocolate cake, followed by a couple of cups of tea and maybe a glass of water, and then you head out to go and see what the wonders of the wilderness have to give you. Yes, I can see them. Thank you so much, Fiam. There are some warthogs, everybody. The second lot of warthogs we've seen today. The first lot ran away. These guys are much more confiding. Looks like a young sow. I wish you could hear them. I don't think, yeah, with the wind blowing, I don't think you're going to be able to hear them, but they're making this amazing crunching sound as they pull the roots of these plants out of the ground. So if you've watched the other animals grazing, you've watched the zebra grazing and the impala, and you can see in the buffalo especially, they all eat a different piece of the grass plant. Longest would be the buffalo. They wrap their tongues around the grass and then pull it out, which always makes my, you know, that horrible feeling you get in kind of just underneath yourself when it's the feeling of scraping nails across blackboards, etc., and the thought of wrapping my tongue around grass and pulling gives me that horrible feeling. Anyway, they eat the longest grass, and then we get to the zebra, which eats slightly shorter grass than them, and then, say, the wildebeest or the impala will eat even shorter grass than that, and then you get down to these fellows, the warthogs, and you can see the snout snuffling along at ground level and actually pulling the roots of the grass plant out and eating those. And while that may seem destructive, well, I suppose it probably is if you happen to be the individual grass plant, remember that everything out here, from the warthog to the elephant to the flea beetle to the black monkey thorn and the cambrium tree here, and every grass species has evolved to create, to fill all the niches that are available here. And so that warthog is playing a very crucial role, probably clearing space for other plants to grow, killing off the dead stuff and the moribund plants. But you can see right there at ground level, that cartilaginous snout. That's a lovely word, don't you think, Viam? Cartilaginous.
I wasn't listening.
No, of course, sorry. I forgot. Viam's not listening to me today. Cartilaginous, of course, means a big flat disc in front of the nose that is made of cartilage that you can see there it's using to dig. See, he is actually listening to me. He's just pretending not to. And again, you can see those bottom tusks there, so sharp. You do not want to be set upon by those things. Difficult to describe a warthog as elegant, I must say, but she is a relatively elegant female, I suppose. She's got very impressive whiskers. We had a warthog sow yesterday with equally impressive whiskers. That's probably her offspring there, as opposed to her consort. It's a young male, and I suspect he's just a little bit much... Well, he's much too young to be her consort. I think he's just living with her because he's probably her offspring from a previous litter. And he will eventually have to go off on his own, probably when she has her next litter. And there he goes into the shade. Right, the water's not too far from here. Let's pop down there and have a look. Here are some impalas. We're just going to ease our way past. And while we're easing past the impala, the mixed feeders, let's go to the grazing dressage ponies that Byron has found.
And look what we have found on the plains. Beautiful herd of zebra. We had some wildebeest earlier, but they have moved off into a thicket. But these zebra are enjoying the clearings. Lovely to see them. A group of zebra have an interesting name. They're often known as a dazzle of zebra. And you can understand why with those stripes. I think it does seem as if they are dazzling. They do blend in very well when they're standing very close to each other. A lot of oxpeckers around them at the moment, all sitting, picking off the ticks. This looks like a harem. It looked like the stallion that moved off a little way earlier. And I think he's standing by himself off to the left. And then the others would be females. And then there's that zebra foal that is off to the right too. There we go. I think that's a stallion up ahead that other zebra is walking towards. Very, very beautiful. These animals, the zebra and the wildebeest, really do enjoy these clearings. It's a nice area for them to find food and water. And also, what happens is it's a nice area to make sure they are safe. It's very open, it's very clear. They can see if any predators are coming from a very long way away. Often you'll find zebra and wildebeest in the same area, and they will warn each other if there are any predators. They have an interesting relationship too, because both these species of animals are grazers, which means they only eat grass. The zebra, however, generally prefer feeding on the longer grass, whereas the wildebeest prefer feeding on shorter grass. So there isn't actually a direct competition between these two species. They form a different niche. What happens is there's no competition, so they wouldn't compete for the same food. There's enough food around, and that's often why you find these two species in the same area. A niche means the role that they play in nature. So the zebra and the wildebeest fill a different niche. This is really lovely. Beautiful, beautiful afternoon with the zebras standing out in the open. Now, there are a number of theories behind why zebra have stripes. Just before we do that, if we look over to the left, there's two zebras standing next to each other. Look at that. Zebra often stand in this manner, head to tail. And look at those tails swishing around, keeping the flies away from the tail area or the rump. But one of the reasons why they stand head to tail is as those tails are flicking around, they also keep the flies away from each other's faces. It's not unusual to see zebras standing like this. Look how well they blend in. As I was saying, one of the theories behind the stripes, and the one that I think is the most plausible, is the zebra have these beautiful stripes to help them get away from predators. What happens is if lions, for example, are hunting them and the zebra run away in a herd, the theory is that the stripes blend in with one another and it is very difficult for the predators to distinguish between each individual. And again, I say this is a theory because we are not always 100% sure if we are correct with our theories. It's just something that scientists have thought of. Another theory is that it regulates body temperature. I do not think that is the case. I think that one with them blending in and making it difficult for the predator to distinguish between each individual is probably more likely. These zebras seem to be very comfortable in the clearing. James has one of my favorite birds.
Oh. Look at them fighting. Look, 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 watch here. Here they come. That was fascinating. We were watching that bird for ages and I thought maybe we'd frightened it away. Awesome. He's now just gone and sat up, but obviously there was a youngster there. I don't know if you managed to see the fact that the second one there had a lot of white on the upper wing. That signifies it was a juvenile. Now, just underneath it, of course, there's an elephant. Ooh. And I was going to suggest that we go a little bit closer to that elephant, but Viam, that necessity has no longer relevant, because just behind us, three young bulls are coming to the pub. Hello, fellows. Here we are at Arethusa Dam. And these chaps are probably going to have a little bit of a drink and a mud wallow or a spray of mud and a little investigation of us to see what we want. Isn't that a wonderful sound? To many people, that sound of the fish eagle is the quintessential sound of Africa. And they're looking at us, and these young bulls, I'm telling you, I think they come up here. They could easily have gone to another part of the dam. I think half of it is curiosity to see what we want. We'll go above them. I just want to give them a little bit of a head start so we don't give them a fright. And there's some bigger ones coming from the other side. So I think we're going to park ourselves here on the Arethusa Dam wall for a little while and see what transpires. I also wonder if that hippo that we saw earlier when we started the drive wasn't... Oh, no, there he is. I thought it was maybe the hippo from here. These chaps are just a little bit nervous for me to park right above them. I'm just going to stop everyone and let them settle. Are you looking at us there? Maybe they'll go around the other side there and settle. And while they do that, Fiampi, if you don't just show them the hippo there and the foul mud there. Oh, Safari Dean, a wonderful question from you and one that has an extremely complicated and lengthy answer if you really get into it. Your question is, do I think that hippos are as intelligent as elephants? Safari Dean, the simple answer to that is just every by with its kind of life. Now, do I think, I mean, and then we have to ask the question, what is intelligence? How do we define it? Is a lion intelligent? Well, a lion is intelligent in so much that it's able to cooperatively hunt with other lions. But at the same time, if you speak to any big cat trainer, they'll tell you a lion is a quite imbecilic animal. It's unlike a leopard, for example, which will learn things much more quickly. So which one is intelligent? As far as human intelligence goes, the intelligence to understand, I guess that human intelligence is defined as the ability to have and conceive of abstract thoughts, then I suppose, I imagine an elephant would be considered more intelligent than a hippo because they do show this propensity to mourn their dead. They seem to have a more complicated language. So from a human point of view, yes, I suppose hippo would be considered less intelligent than elephants. But from a hippo's point of view, they're just as clever as they need to be to survive, and they've done really well. Look how deep that mud is. I'm just going to keep an eye out behind us. See, those other two don't come through here. I think they probably will. This is wonderful. And they all, of course, they don't really want to sink into the mud before they can have a drink. I don't think they'll do too much drinking here. I think you'll find that they're doing far more in the way of spraying mud on themselves and then eating the water hyacinth. You can see there. Oops. Excuse me. That was my stomach, everybody, going whoop. Probably at the sight of the elephant eating that delicious water hyacinth. So here come the other two. I wonder if they're not just a little bit nervous, still assessing the situation. Now, these guys are probably all roughly sort of late teens, if you like. They'll be living on their own because they've set up a digs, a bit like sort of young students. Men won't live on their own until they are either in a group or, you know, they won't leave their mothers home cooking unless they can live in a group like this, and it's exactly the same with elephants. They would normally still be with the herd at this age, I imagine. But these chaps are spending a bit of time on their own because they have each other for safety and for company. And this is their sort of digs, where they hang around together. That's quite a nice picture there. You can hear the hippo going in his mud. And these guys are really quite stuck in the mud there now. Hello, Laura in Alabama. You've just heard that hippopotamus calling there. You've just heard it going, and you want to know if it's able to breathe under all that mud. Laura, hippo don't breathe under the mud. They can't breathe underwater in the same way that a whale and a dolphin is unable to breathe under the water. And so what they do is they must come to the surface, and that's exactly what that thing has done there. It's come to the surface, and it's breathing. There we go. Isn't that wonderful? So they'll hide themselves, and they can definitely put their, you know, they can hold their breath for a long time. But you'll find that they cannot breathe underwater, and they must come up. Apparently the longest that a hippo is able to stay under the water is about 8 minutes. I've never seen a hippo stay under the water for anything like that length of time. It's normally a maximum of a minute at a time. I guess unless they're really threatened. Wonderful. Isn't that nice? Oh, okay. Hang on, everybody. The last station confirm how far east along Gari Main. This is Shadow and her cub, everyone. Okay, copy. I'm going to try and make my way there. I'm at Arethusa Dam now. Okay, everybody, Shadow and her cub, our 9-year-old female leopard, great friend of ours, the princess of Juma, if you like, is heading north towards our southern boundary with her baby. That suggests to me that she might have a kill somewhere. I think it's going to be worth our while to leave these fellows, magnificent as they are. We haven't seen her and her cub for a while, and let's see if we can't go and get a picture of her and her tiny little, almost 4-month-old cub. Right, here we go. So everyone, we're not going to drive too quickly. We're going to drive with, well, we're going to drive with a relative purpose, but not too fast, simply because we don't know exactly where Shadow's going to go. I thought I'd lost my lens cap. I have not. I think that at least 8 times a day. Right, we're just going past Arethusa Lodge here, obviously. And then we're going to go relatively fast, but not breakneck speed. She is still south of the boundary, which means we won't be able to see her just yet. Ah, yeah. And there's a fellow chopping some wood for the camp. And as I've said to you before, these camps at this time of the day are actually great fun. They really kind of quiet and down. And if you ever worked in a camp like this, or if you ever come and spend an extended period out at one, it's almost worth spending an afternoon in camp, especially if it's got a lovely waterhole like that in front of it, and just seeing what comes by. And often you'll see more than they do on game drive. Whoop, whoop. That was a really lovely elephant sighting. I could very happily have spent another hour or so with those fellows, but I do want to see Shadow and her little baby. Her little baby who I've named Zara. I'll let you decide why she's called Zara. These will not be official names, everyone. Don't panic. I've no doubt others will give them official names, in theory only when they're a year old. We've asked them if, for the sake of our viewers, who are many and varied, and do care so very deeply about the animals out here, if we couldn't perhaps name them a little earlier this time round, but we've yet to hear back. This naming convention thing, as I discussed this morning, takes on a life of its own, and it becomes, it becomes a discussion and a political wrangling, the likes of which the US presidential and Brexit discussions could not even rival. So I'm not going to tell anybody what I've named them. I'll be in big trouble. I'll be excommunicated from the guiding fraternity. That would be terrible, wouldn't it, VM? Yes. Extricated. No. Not extricated. Excommunicated.
Yeah.
Yes. Yes. Exactly. Right, here is the Arethusa International Airstrip. There are some impalas. We will have a quick look at them as we go round. Now, in case you're wondering where Byron is, he's on cheetah plains, but apparently it's impossible to talk to him at the moment. I suspect quite strongly because his earpiece has pulled out of where it's supposed to be, unless he's trying to climb a tree. But I don't think he's trying to do that. He's quite a beefy fellow, is our Byron. Have a quick look at these impalas who have come out early onto the open area to try and avoid being devoured by something. And I suppose it's also because there's grass left. If you look here at the airstrip, for some reason this particular piece has been left free of eating, and there's actually some green grass left, which I find very interesting and very strange at the same time. Right, let's carry on. All right, Byron can hear Kirsten McLennan Smith now. Let's go across to him, get an update. I will keep you posted on Shadow.
So we've been moving around these clearings on Cheetah Plains and we haven't had any luck just yet. I know James had some ostriches around here today, or this morning at least, and we haven't seen anything. It is a little bit windy, so I think what's possibly happened, a lot of animals just moved off into the thicket. They don't really like to be out in the wind, and I think that's possibly what has happened. But a lot of elephant tracks all over the road here where we are at the moment, and fresh signs that they were here, branches that have been broken off and fresh dung. So maybe we find some elephants shortly. Let's have a look. A lot of branches all over the place. See another big branch in front of us. So Emma from the UK is coming out to South Africa soon, and she's heading to Kruger National Park. Emma would like to know what my favorite road is in Kruger National Park, or area to drive around. Emma, I haven't been to Kruger National Park, or the park itself, for quite some time. I was there about 2 years ago. I'm trying to think. The area around Skakuza, which is one of the camps in Kruger, is I think, one of the nicest areas. From Skakuza and further south, Crocodile Bridge, that area. But Skakuza for me is very, very nice. There's some beautiful water holes and the river. Look at all the damage elephants have done here. A lot of the branches that have been broken. But what this is probably from is because the tree is dead. This marula tree is dead, and it would have been caused by elephant. And these branches have been broken off or fallen off. This tree is rotting at the moment. Such a shame, but it does happen. But it creates a micro habitat for a lot of other animals, a lot of other insects. So Emma, getting back to your question, best place in Kruger or area in Kruger, as I said, I really like Skakuza area, beautiful river, the Sabi River, yes, the Sabi River that runs through past Kruger, past Skakuza, and there's generally a lot of wildlife. I've been very fortunate. I've seen leopard in that area, I've seen lion, I've seen cheetah, but again, you can never guarantee what you're going to see. It all depends on the time of year, and it depends how patient you are and what you can find. Wondering where all those elephants moved off to, but they could have moved through the area much earlier today. And we've all seen how quickly elephant can cover or move through an area and disappear very, very quickly if they want to. Constantly moving, just feeding. And then what they'll do is they'll move from one waterhole to another. Especially in these dry seasons or these dry conditions, they do need to drink quite a lot of water, so they will know exactly where the water holes are in the area, and they'll move from one water hole to another. Love driving through these combretum thickets. You've got these beautiful colors. Just look at the coloration that we can see, this yellow and brown and green. We often hear the rustling of the leaves while we're driving through in the wind at the moment. We've got this beautiful sound. Let's see if that little bird, which I just saw, will stay there. Don't move. He's still there. Let's see if Brian can get him. You see him through there, Brian? Just behind those trees. That is an emerald spotted wood dove. Look carefully there, he's just hiding through there. And if you look closely, just on the back of the wing, you can see if the light hits it, especially, you get this beautiful emerald coloration on the wing. Really, really beautiful little bird. He seems to be hiding from us there. So while we carry on, I'm going to try to see if I can't find this elephant somewhere. While I do that, cross over to James for an update and see what he's up to. I hope he's not climbing any trees.
Look at that, everybody. There's an elephant right here. I don't know what's happening with Shadow. I can't get hold of anybody on the radio, but this young bull is starting being... He's having great fun here. He's so close to us. Wonderful bull here. He's probably about 10 years old, and he was only about 3 feet from us. beautiful. All right, let's go a little bit forward. I'm just going to ask this fellow in front of us here. I'm trying to understand what's going on with the leopard. She should be just off here. Elephants everywhere here, beautiful herd. I'm going to ask this chap here. How dong in chome ya ingwe? The crossil. Okay, hold on everybody. She's crossed over into Wiatela. We're just going to try and get past here. Aguna muna famanato. Okay, enkom. All right, everyone, apparently she has crossed over. Let's go back to Byron, find out what he's doing, and I will keep you posted.
That's exciting news. James is racing to see if he can get a glimpse of Shadow, the leopard. I hope he does. We are still wandering through cheetah plains. I've been looking for some elephant, and there's signs of them everywhere, but they don't seem to be sticking their heads out this afternoon. Well, not just yet, but as I always say, it's too soon to panic. While we are driving, yesterday I was asked an interesting question about what animals fly, and I wasn't too sure about the question, but giving it more thought, I think what the question was about is what is the largest mammal that can fly? So the only mammal that can fly is a bat, and fly properly, and those are bats. So that is definitely, if I understood that question correctly, a mammal that can fly is a bat. And then this morning, we had a few questions about the elephant and their tusks. And I did mention that they do have nerve endings that run through the tusk, but it's basically one nerve which runs straight through the tusk, just like our teeth. So if a tusk is broken, it can harm the elephant, and you can sometimes get an infection in the tusk. But generally, they do manage to heal quite quickly. But the tusk is just like our teeth. So you can imagine a big tusk breaking off. It can cause quite a bit of pain for the elephant. But they do not grow back. So once that tusk has broken off or snapped off, they don't grow back. So Debbie from New Jersey has asked, what is my favorite thing that's ever happened to me in the bush? Debbie, that's a tough question. I think my favorite thing that's ever happened to me in the bush was coming to work in the bush, to be honest. And I'll tell you why, is because I love everything about it. I really enjoy the wildlife and being out here and seeing different things constantly on a daily basis. It's always different. But I also enjoy interacting with the people. I enjoy taking people on game drives and showing them around and showing them what this country has to offer. Or not just this country, but Africa in general. It's really one of my passions to be able to pass on the knowledge and interpret the bush to the guests that they can understand it a bit better. I think in terms of sightings though, I mentioned it the other day, someone asked a similar question, but I saw a leopard make an impala kill right in front of us. It happened at, you know, everything. We stopped the vehicle, she stalked, she walked behind the vehicle, she walked around and she used the thicket line and moved into position to stalk some impala. and she snuck up right in towards them, very, very close, and then she sprung and caught an impala right in front of us. It was incredible. As she did, she dragged it off towards a tree, started feeding, and the next thing, she got up, moved off, and she went and called about a kilometer down the road. She called, gave a little low, very low call, which is a contact call, a lot of big cats do. Sounds like a oh, oh, oh. And she called, and the next thing, three cubs came out. And these little cubs came out towards her, and that was incredible in its own. And she took them to the kill that she had just made, and the three cubs got to feed while she lay one side and kept watch. And that is definitely, I think, one of my favorite sightings I've ever had. Just because, one, it's amazing to see a kill. It doesn't just happen. You've got to really, really have patience and try and wait in an area and spend a lot of time with a predator to see them actually hunt and kill. And the other thing is, a leopard with cubs is not something you see often. So that whole scene was just really wonderful. So Kevin has asked us a question about the predators. Kevin would like to know which predator is the most successful in terms of chasing and catching prey. So Kevin, I would say the most successful is the African wild dog. And the wild dogs are, they are pack animals, so they work together. But unlike lions that work in a pride, that stalk and push prey, they work a little bit differently. So what the wild dogs do is they will run through an area and they'll cover huge distances very, very quickly throughout a morning or an afternoon. They're generally active during the day, not really at night. They will hunt morning and afternoons. And what they do is while they are running, they literally just wait to see what they can flush out of a thicket or in an area. And what they do is they work together and they'll just run down their prey. They are persistence hunters, but they're incredibly accurate with their hunting skill and very, very successful hunters. So they have the highest success rate. I would say they're sitting on almost 70 to 80%, if not more, whereas lion and leopard, probably only about 20 to 30% of their success. We haven't had very much success this afternoon just yet. We have lots of time left this afternoon, so we'll see what we can find. Oh, kudu. Kudu, kudu. Yeah, look at that. Just as I was saying, you never know what you're going to bump into. Look at these beautiful kudu cows, the females. Those beautiful stripes down the body. Those very, very big ears. The kudu like to move through thickets. So the theory is that these large ears, and let me just move back slightly, there is one feeding. You might get a nice view of it. There we go. See those big ears? Look at that, fixed on us now. Beautiful reddish pink coloration inside the ear. So the theory is that because these kudu are often moving through thickets, they need these big ears to be able to listen out for any predators. But their eyesight is also incredible. They're very, very alert. And they give this amazing alarm call if there is any danger around. They'll give off a bark. A very strange sound, like a rough bark. And it sounds almost like a bow, bow, bow. And that's their alarm call. Don't think my kudu impersonation is very good, but it sounds something similar to that. I don't know if Brian can do one. There we go. Brian's is a little bit better than mine. but they are fantastic. And there's another species of antelope we find in this area known as the Inyala. That is spelt N-Y-A-L-A, Inyala. And the Inyala has similar coloration to the kudu. Also beautiful white stripes down the body, but the kudu is much larger. And the Inyala male and female look very, very different to one another. Let me show you a picture quickly. I'll find it. Oh, here we go. The kudu males have those beautiful big spiral horns which twist and turn up. The females don't have any horns, but they are very beautiful. This is an image of the Inyala, the male and the female. And have a look at how different they are. See the beautiful male over here, very dark gray animal with a lot of hair, very thick coat. And those beautiful horns, they don't spiral as much as the kudu do, but they do twist slightly. And then have a look at the female lower down. Look at these females. See, they look quite similar to those kudu, but they are much smaller and they've got a reddish brown coloration as opposed to the kudu, which have that dark brown or russet coloration. Very beautiful to see the difference. These are the only antelope where the male and female look so different. They almost look like they are different antelope or different species. So Monique in London has asked us, how tall are kudu? And I'm trying to think exactly. I think most of the time they are measured from shoulder height, or they are given a shoulder height and not completely all the way up to the head. But I think shoulder height for kudu is about 1.5 meters. Generally 1.5 meters. So that's just up to the shoulder, which is quite high. So with the head, I mean, you know, 1.5 meters is, you know, very tall. And I'm trying to think, I'm about, I think 1.7 meters. I think no, 1.6, 1.65 meters. So kudu shoulder would be round about here. And then with the head, they'd be much taller than me. So they're large antelope. They are very large antelope. One of the largest in this area. Very beautiful. They've just moved off into the thicket. Let us continue. We're going to start making our way back towards Juma. We're going to leave Cheetah Plains. We'll see what we find along the way. The wind seems to have died down a little bit, not as bad as it was earlier, which is good, it's nice. Then, but I'm sure, and like as Brian and I were chatting earlier, we think possibly there's a front coming through, which could bring some colder weather. While we're driving back, James is still on the search for Shadow, so we'll give him a bit more time and see if he doesn't find her for you this afternoon. As soon as he does, he will update me, but for now, you're stuck with me and Brian. And the thumb, and Brian's got an ominous thumb this afternoon. He's brought Franken thumb. Just going to move off the road. It appears as if there are some guests arriving at one of the lodges. Afternoon, everyone. See some guests arriving. They've got their cameras out already. They're filming. That's fantastic to see. Some of these areas you are able to drive in your own vehicles, and once you get to the lodges, they will then take your vehicle, park it somewhere, and then you get taken out on safari by the guides that work at those lodges. So Sarah from Georgia would like to know, are there any camels in this Greater Kruger area, or animals that are related to camels? Any animals related to camel? No, there are not. There are no animals related to camel. Not in this area, not at all. Not in Southern Africa. I know you've seen some of these antelope, like the kudu, that appear to have a hump on their back. But all that is there's a lot of muscle that extends up from the shoulders and across the neck. And that is because they've got these long necks, which allows them to feed, and they carry those big heavy horns, the males do at least. So there's a lot of muscles in that. That's what those humps are. It's not like a camel hump that you would be used to seeing. So no, there are no animals which resemble camel in this area. So Aaron in New Zealand has asked me, have I ever seen a gemsbok? Another word for the gemsbok is the oryx. And Aaron, I have. I've seen many gemsbok. I've been very fortunate. I guide in different areas around Southern Africa. And one of the areas that gemsbok are very prevalent is up in the western part of South Africa, northwestern part, all the way up into Namibia and parts of Botswana. And I've guided there many times, and there are plenty of gemsbok or oryx in those areas. They prefer the semi-arid to dry conditions, as opposed to these areas in the northeastern part of South Africa, where there's a lot more rainfall. It's a lot greener. I thought I saw something move. I think my eyes are just playing tricks on me. Just want to make sure. No, I did see something. There are two little steenbok. See if we can get them through there. Oh, off they go. Did you get that? You all saw the glimpse of the steenbok? Just shows you. You've got to constantly be scanning while you're out here. It's very difficult to spot these little antelope. They're very, very quick, agile, and they blend in really well to these camouflage leaves, or their camouflage blends in really well to these leaves, especially this time of year when it is so dry. And there are a lot of brown colors at the moment. And those antelope are all brown, so they blend in very, very well. Trying to see if I can find you a picture quickly of a gemsbok, just to show you what they look like. They are very, very beautiful. See, how's my multitasking? Driving and reading a book at the same time. There we go. Let me just slow down and show you quickly. So have a look. That's a gemsbok. It's one of my favorite antelope. They are really, really beautiful, but you can see where this picture has been taken. It's a very, very dry, desolate area. And those gemsbok thrive in those areas. Also known as the oryx. Very, very beautiful, beautiful antelope. Very large, very quick. They're very stocky animals, very muscular. When they run, they really do look amazing when they run across the desert. I often see the dust as they're running, see the dust being kicked up behind them. Wonderful. Alright, while we're heading back towards Juma, head over to Jay and see if he's got an update on Shadow.
Right, everybody, we're knocking about here in the bush. Roy unfortunately lost the leopard as she walked onto this reserve. No one was with her. He couldn't follow her on here. And so she disappeared into this woodland. Lex is around here. Andrew's around here. So there are three of us looking now for Shadow and her little cub. They're in here somewhere, or they're still heading north. Roy's thought was that maybe she's got a kill somewhere close by. And so with any luck, she will. You know, with Karula, you always know but that you just have to look in the trees and eventually you're going to see a dangling limb. But we know that Shadow is a very bad hoister of kills. And so, we're, you know, in this kind of bush, we're into the needle and haystack sort of stuff. But she headed directly this way. But that was now some time ago. And of course, the trail gets immeasurably colder very quickly after you see the leopards. So we'll keep going through here. We might be very lucky. There are flies abounding over my face. Here goes Andrew. Andrew, go ahead. Andrew's just saying he walked. Andrew says he walked the whole drainage line. Copy. Did you walk the whole drainage there, Andrew? So Andrew didn't see anything, and he walked the whole donga there. Andrew, do you think she could still be on the south then? So he walked this whole drainage line. Just listening to Andrew saying, he says she was moving quite quickly, so we could easily have missed the tracks. All right. Okay, copy. Thanks, Andrew. So she disappeared into this thicket now about 20 minutes ago. Andrew says he didn't see anything of her crossing the drainage, but if she was keeping going, if she was just moving straight forward, then she would have crossed. So what we're going to do, we're going to go dead straight in on the tracks where she went in, see if we can reach the drainage line. Have you got them there, Vim? So she crossed here. And if we don't pick her up before the drainage, we'll have to go around and then we're going to be well into the ranks of needle in the haystack. But she might pop out. Lex has gone around that way to see if she doesn't come across, but this block is enormous. Right, while we do this, let's go back to Byron and see what he's got.
So James hasn't had any luck just yet with Shadow, but I've got a lot of faith in him. I'm sure we're going to have some luck a little bit later. While he's around there, we are almost back on Juma. We'll see what we can find. But it's great having you with me and answering all your questions. So please don't stop sending them in and your comments. It's always great to hear from everyone from all over the world. This morning we had that beautiful African harrier hawk on that gymnogene sitting up in the tree. And we saw it actually perched on a stump. And we could see how it was putting its head in looking for potential food. And as it flew, I picked up my camera and tried to get a few pictures. I got one or two. I put them on Twitter if anybody would like to see them. And hashtag Safari Live, you can have a look. So Michael has asked us if we have any species of hummingbirds in Africa. Michael, I'm trying to think now in North Africa, but I don't think so. Just trying to think quickly. We definitely don't have any in Southern Africa. trying to think of East Africa. I don't believe we have either. I'm not too sure about North Africa, but the whole way is Southern Africa, that we don't have any species of hummingbirds at all. We do have different birds which hover in a similar fashion to the hummingbirds. One of them is one of the species of kingfishers. The kingfishers, some of them that do hunt fish, they split into two parts, actually, the family of kingfishers. One part hunt fish and will dive down into water and try and hunt fish. And the other species of, or groups of kingfishers hunt insects. Just gonna wait here a second. Those fish or kingfishers, what they do is they will fly up and they'll hover. They keep their heads incredibly still and fixed, and they'll look down and they hover, very similar to what a hummingbird does. And then they'll drop down and dive down into the water and catch a fish, and then fly up and perch where they eat the fish. It's incredible to see. The other species, or the other groups of kingfishers, will fly around in thickets and they catch insects on the wing. They're incredible hunters. Beautiful birds too, but no hummingbirds. Have a look around this area. I know James was searching intently the other day in this area for Karula. Apparently she was seen just south of where we are now. Maybe we have a little bit of luck, you never know. It's always worth having a good look around an area. Trying to see if there are any tracks. The tracks of a big elephant that walked through here. Looks like a big bull. Very large round track. Actually, you just see just off to the side of the road, you can have a look. See those big round tracks of the elephant. Quite difficult to drive around these areas, scan and look for tracks. Chris Rogue has asked another question just regarding those, or that camel question, and Chris Rogue has asked, aren't giraffes related to camels? I don't believe they are, Chris Rogue, not at all. The name giraffe in Afrikaans is known as kameelpaard, which means camel horse. But that is just the name. It's not because of any relation to the camel. Right, I think it's time that we find some animals. We need to start looking very carefully, Brian. We've got that beautiful golden light now. This is the best time of the afternoon to find something, especially any predators, because that afternoon sunlight is beautiful for photography. So I'm going to look very, very hard in these areas. Moving through wonderful drainage lines now. And these drainage lines are ideal for big cats, especially leopard, to move through. So So Rob Reiner would like to ask if we have any okapi down in southern Africa. No, Rob, we do not. So okapi are predominantly up in East Africa. It is a species of giraffe. They do fall under the giraffe family, but we do not get them down here at all. We only have one species of giraffe in southern Africa, and it is the southern giraffe. Up in East Africa, there are many different other species, but we do not get them down here. A few days ago, Brian and I were very lucky. We found two giant eagle owls, or Varroa's eagle owls, sitting in this drainage line just further down. And they are really beautiful, beautiful owls. And we heard them calling. We managed to find them perched high up in the trees. They like to sit in the thick trees, and then in the evenings, they'll come out and hunt. Elephant, yes. Look at that, straight ahead. Ah, you see. Beautiful elephant bull. I'm just gonna stop here. He's sweating a little bit from those temporal glands, those glands on the side of the head. And he is in a state known as must. And must bulls can sometimes be a little temperamental. What that is there's a lot of testosterone. Oh, you see that dripping between his legs? That is a clear sign that this elephant is in must. So what happens is, this is when they have a lot of testosterone and hormones flowing through their body. They are ready to mate with females. And it does cause him to become a little bit agitated. But he's a beautiful specimen. Wow, look at those tusks. What a nice surprise. I love seeing these big elephant bulls. Let's try and move a little bit forward. I'm trying to see if I can smell him. Yes, definitely. The wind has just changed and I can smell him. Very pungent smell. Just going to try and move a little bit forward. See if we can't get a view from the other side. The light on the other side is very, very nice at the moment. Marianne from Arkansas has asked, oh, he seems to be going the other way now, hold on. Marianne from Arkansas has asked, if an elephant breaks a tusk, is there a tree that they can feed on that can help with the pain? Let's just watch him, look at that, beautiful. So Marianne, not that I know of. I don't think there is anything that will help a large elephant for pain. A lot of the trees have medicinal uses, but I think that's mainly for people, locals that have discovered certain trees which may potentially help for pain, for fever, for stomach cramps, stomach ailments. But I don't think it would work for large animals like this. Beautiful, look at that. Look at the afternoon sunlight on him. Wonderful. That's really, really great. Isn't that wonderful? Nice surprise. Beautiful big elephant bull in must, but luckily he wasn't too fazed by us. He just kept his kept his distance and off he's gone, moved into the thicket. And with a situation like that, there's no reason to try and follow him now. We know he's in must. We know they can become a bit temperamental. We had a wonderful view of him. Rather leave him, keep him relaxed, keep him happy, and he's moved on. So Marianne, getting back to your question, one of the trees out here known as the knob thorn, it's an acacia tree, an acacia nigrescens. Now the knob thorn gets these little knobs which form on the bark and the stem or in the trunk of these trees. One of the theories and one of the local beliefs is that if you cut off one of these little bumps or knobs of the knob thorn and you chew on it, it can help for toothache. But again, that's for us, and it's a local medicine. It's not necessarily proven that it does work, and I don't think it would help a large elephant. So I don't think there is anything that would really help them with the toothache. All right. Hopefully James is back on the vehicle. Go and see if he has an update for us.
Indeed, back on the vehicle, no update. So, we did a long walk along the drainage line here. This is where we were hoping that the leopard might be. Andrew is in there searching fervently, but he's come up with nothing. That's the route that we took in there. And just to give you a picture, all right, you can actually get quite a nice view from here. Roy says she was heading in this direction through this thicket and up here, and he saw her on this road at about 1 o'clock this afternoon. Now, it's his guess that she's either killed something in here or she's killed something in just inside Arethusa. She went to fetch the cub and she's bringing the cub to whatever that she's killed. So, with people circling all over the place, people having a look around to see, but unfortunately at this stage, niggies. And it is so easy for these leopards to hide, and especially because Shadow does not put her kills inside trees. And VM keeps spotting leopard tracks because she's been up and down this road. And James Richard, I agree with you. Shadow is her mother's daughter, but she's also part of her rest of her kin, her kind. And like you say, they are exceptional at not being seen if they don't wish to be seen. Now, we're just going to drive past here. I think that was the termite mound, wasn't it, Viam? That was the termite mound that Sindile was on the other day, or was it not? I thought maybe, you know, she would have smelt her old boy and decided she needed to move along, say hi. Anyway, we'll see what else we can see. Like I said to you, it does become needle in a haystack stuff. There is a kudu there. I spotted a kudu. Did you see it, Viam? I'll show it to you. There it is. There are a number of kudu in there. Just there, hiding, like the leopard. You see them? There they are. It's a brilliant sighting, isn't it? The best yet. One ear, and an eye, and a mouth. And we're going to do this sort of thing for a little while and drive around this block. We'll stop at everything that we can stop at. Let's just see if the leopard don't pop out. Of course, we will keep checking behind us in case she pops out there as well. But I wonder if she hasn't got something delicious in here for her to eat. Oh, Michael. Michael, you're courting all sorts of controversy here. You say, is it true that Shadow's father is also Karula's father and therefore is inbreeding a problem? I think there's some debate over that, but certainly the consensus seems to be that indeed, I'm going to be stabbed in the eye, that Shadow's father is indeed Karula's father, which in turn means that Shadow and Karula are both mother and daughter and sisters. Now, while that in the human population would be an utterly detestable set of circumstances, it's not in the cats. It really doesn't make a huge difference. They can apparently inbreed for up to... I'm being savaged by flies here. They can inbreed for up to 6 generations without it being too effective to the gene pool. It was over there. That's where Sandile was, in there on a termite mound. There. You see there, Viam? That was it. That's where Viam found the tapeworm. Well done, Viam. So we watched Sandile being sick on top of that mound, and on top of it, Viam insisted after drive on going back to see what was in there. And there was a huge tapeworm in his vomit, sort of that long. Now, as far as I was aware, you couldn't get rid of a tapeworm like that, but clearly I was wrong. Where he got the tapeworm is a matter of some interest, I think. We should have kept it for the tent. Yes. Ugh. I've got to tell you, a freshly vomited tapeworm is not something you want to handle. Even if it's not freshly vomited, I imagine a tapeworm is not something you really want to handle at all. Hello, Ava. A very solidly good question. You are a new viewer, and it's lovely to have you with us. Sorry, I'm being inundated by flies, as you can see. You can also see that I missed a few spots with my haircut today. Ava, you want to know if it's dangerous to follow the leopard. Could she turn around and lash out? Ava, she could easily turn around and lash out if we're on foot and she feels threatened. It's a bush that I'm looking at. There's a fly in the back of my head, Viam, that if it doesn't die this time round, I will be very upset. I think I got it. Now, no, I didn't get it. It's back again, the other side. So, Ava, if you're on foot, you've got to be careful. You most certainly need to watch out and listen for any signs. And you need to make sure that you don't get into a position where the leopard is threatened. So you can easily threaten a leopard, especially if she's got a cub, by kind of cornering her by mistake. And so what you have to do is be very careful that you don't corner her and let her know that you're coming. It's not a bad idea just to make a little bit of noise, crunching a few leaves, so that the leopard moves off if she hears you coming, or she growls and lets you know that she's there, which is normally what will happen. And we can very easily get very blasé about following these animals, and it's very dangerous to do that, because it's when you are blasé that an area like this does pose a danger to you. And there's a great example, of course. Shadow's mother, Karula, also her sister, had a situation the other day where she started charging vehicles. And I think it's because we got too familiar with her, we got too close to her, and she eventually just got irritated. Thought, that's ridiculous, you're too close now, I won't put up with this. Yilwe. Yilwe ntongwane, yingenela, yifambeso. She's crossed the road here. See that, Vimpy? You can't see that side. Let's have a quick look here. You can stay with me, everybody. We, of course, will look around, especially for Ava's benefit. So there are tracks here. Here they go. They're underneath the vehicle here. There's a termite mound, and we know Shadow loves termite mounds. They're underneath the vehicle. Here they go. They're going up here. They cross in there. Right. This is good news. This is good news. Let's just see. I'm just going to quickly check that mound with me binoculars. See if she isn't sitting on top there. She is not. There are many leopard-shaped pieces of that mound. All right, let me just call this in quickly. All right, let me just call this in. So can you see her there, Vimpy? She goes down here, and she's crossed in over there, I think. Can you see them going in there, or is she going along the road? Oh, she's on the road here. She's still on the road. There we go. Okay. Sturgeons, I've located the tracks. Tracks, not the animal, the tracks of Shadow and Cub crossing back west into Arethusa, just to the south of Red Dam Road. I'm following up there. Right, so let's go down here and see if she crosses this road. This is very exciting because we know that these tracks are fresh. They must be fresh. It's the female and the cub come down here. That's the termite mound I was looking at. Let's see if she's not on top there. Let's see if she crosses the road. The tracks are heading in this direction. And we've got to be careful of missing them, of course. There. Gimpy, is that them there? No. Let's go gently down this road. This, of course, is not far from where we started our little drive. Okay, while I try and figure out what's going on here, everybody, Byron's at the hyena den. Let's go and find out who's there.
We have got a female lying at the den. Have a look at this beautiful female hyena. No sign of the cubs just yet, but maybe we are lucky and we get them coming out a little bit later. Still got a bit of sunlight, so it is still nice and warm. Might still be a bit of activity before they fall asleep. She is very relaxed at the moment. Sounds like James is having an afternoon like the morning I had. Tracks everywhere, but we just couldn't find a leopard or a lion. Beautiful, look at that. Very, very relaxed. And with a big adult hyena like that, those cubs are completely safe in the den. Just heard something move off in the distance. Can't see anything. It's very thick where we are now. Let's just sit and listen for a little bit. I think it is possibly an elephant that is walking through the thicket, but not too close, quite far from here. Wonderful, look at that large termite mound that this hyena is in. And often animals will use abandoned termite mounds, so termite mounds that are no longer active. They probably do not contain any termites, but this huge termite mound is many, many years old, a few hundred years old, definitely. And what happens is these termite mounds create a great place for animals to den or use as shelter. See, what happens is there's a network of tunnels. Oh, look at that yawn. Oh, do you see those teeth? Those powerful, powerful jaws and sharp teeth. Looks like she's smiling at us. So, as I was saying with the termite mound, the termites create a network of chimneys and tunnels throughout the mound. So what happens is you get animals like warthog perhaps, honey badgers, porcupines, aardvark, all of those animals would come and start digging, and they would use a termite mound as a den or as shelter. Often what happens is once those animals move out, you get other animals coming in, like hyena, a wild dog. They will also use it as a den site. So a lot of animals benefit from these large termite mounds and use them as homes, as the hyenas have used in this situation. They've got a beautiful den site here with a number of entrances. I've seen the one where that female is lying now. There's another one off to the left over there. And I'm almost certain I saw one or two on the other side. So there'll be a few entrances, not necessarily leading to one chamber in the center. Ooh. There's a gray go-away bird screaming above us. And I'm just having a look around. Why is he so upset? It's not giving me a chance to speak. So this gray go-away bird, you hear that sound? Sounds like he's saying, go away, go away. Not very happy at all. And they do alarm call if they see predators. And Ava, you asked for hyena earlier this afternoon. It was your first time with us. And look at that, we managed to find some for you. We try our best to show our viewers what they would like to see. So there we go, just for you, Ava. This grey go-away bird still calling profusely above us. Like I said, I'm just scanning around because you never know. They do pick up on movement of predators. And they do alarm call if they do see anything. I don't think it's alarm calling at the hyena because that hyena is tucked away in the den. But it could potentially also be calling at other birds around. There's another grey go-away bird which has just flown into the tree. Just scanning very carefully here. No, James is still looking for any sign of shadow or trying to work out where she has gone. I think we are a little bit too far for her, or too far from that area for her to pop up around here. But you never know, and there could also be, I'm not saying there is definitely a predator in the area, but often these birds, they do get it right. They do alarm call if there's any threat or any danger, but it's unlikely that a leopard would wander through, especially if there is a hyena den. The reason for that is they can definitely smell them. And leopards don't like bumping into other predators, so they'd probably try and avoid this area. Wonderful sound. So a cat in Tampa, all the way in Tampa, has just mentioned that she's never heard the grey go-away bird that loud before. Yeah, it really is an incredible sound. It's very loud. And you can kind of understand where that name, grey go-away bird, comes from. As I was trying to mimic earlier, it sounds like he's saying, go away, go away. I think you do need a bit of an imagination. Even hyena smiling at me. And it's putting its head down in shame, going, oh dear Byron, don't give up your day job. Stop trying to mimic the birds. Like I said, I think you do need a bit of imagination when listening to bird calls and trying to figure out what they sound like. So peaceful now that the grey go-away bird's flown off, but this warm afternoon sunlight. It's still very warm. The temperature's great. It's perfect. You can still hear some elephant moving in the distance. Can't see any of them, but they are moving through the thicket further on. We did pass one or two elephants on our way here, just off into the bush. But look at that beautiful sunlight coming through. So Ellie, a new viewer, has just asked, what kind of hyena is this? So this is a spotted hyena, Ellie, and it is the only hyena which we have in this area, in this part of South Africa. And I will show you images of the other hyena. Let me just find them quickly for you. I'll show you exactly the different species of hyena which we have. So let me show you quickly. I've got my trusty mammal book out. So, Ellie, as you can see over here, this is a nice picture of the spotted hyena again. There we go. And that's this species of hyena. They are the largest of the hyena, and in this area they are very prominent. There's a lot of hyena in and around the Greater Kruger. They're often in clans, so large families, mainly females with young in those groups. The reason for that is they have a matriarchal society, so the females are the ones that are more dominant. They are larger than the males, and the females are the dominant ones that control the clan. Another species of hyena is the brown hyena. Have a look at that. Now, they have been found in the Kruger in the past, but the brown hyena generally prefers semi-arid to drier areas. They are found up in Botswana, up in Namibia, then the northern part of South Africa and northwestern part, you get a lot of brown hyena activity. They are not always found in large clans like the spotted hyena, but you will see them in groups occasionally. But generally, they do patrol huge territories, huge areas, very, very large areas, alone and looking for food and scavenging, just like the spotted hyena. But not as much as the spotted hyena do. I'm trying to see, there should be another one. The aardwolf, and I don't have an image of the, but the aardwolf forms part of the hyena family. It is not really a hyena, but does fall under the hyena family. And those are found throughout South Africa, but they, or Southern Africa at least, but they are quite difficult to find. Very shy, mainly nocturnal. And you also tend to find them more in semi-arid to dry areas. So that's another species, the aardwolf, which means earth wolf. The aardwolf is an Afrikaans word, it means earth wolf. And I think also because they burrow underground, or not burrow, but they make their homes underground, probably from old termite mounds, and they'll have den sites down there, or aardwark, which is the earth pig, and directly translated means earth pig, and that is what an aardwark looks like. They dig these beautiful, beautiful holes, big holes, incredible diggers. They're very large animals, very strange looking, and they will dig holes, and they will almost bury themselves to an extent if they feel threatened. They dig up sand behind them so you can't get to them. But they will sleep underground during the day and come out at night. And those aardwark holes which have been abandoned, other animals will then use afterwards, like porcupine, the aardwolf, and occasionally hyena. So in a situation like this with this big termite mound, you may have had an aardwark dig up this, or dig a entrance to the termite mound, to potentially get to the termites which are inside. And when they eventually moved off, after a while you get other animals moving in and using it as a home. Wonderful to sit here. We're going to sit here a few more minutes, see if we don't have any luck with the cubs. Hopefully James has got some news for us, but it doesn't sound like it.
Oh, it doesn't sound like it, but I'm going to turn this radio off. Hang on. All right, so the state of play is as follows, everyone. Just over there, I know it's not a very wilderness scene, but there's a transformer. And you saw us there where we crossed into Arethusa to see if we could find the tracks. I can now see tracks of shadow coming down the road here, right next to us, with the cub. Yeah, cub tracks are here as well. These are not fresh. Those ones are fresh. Now, we didn't pick them up. What we did was we drove a road here called Parallel Road all the way up here and see if they crossed. They didn't cross, I don't think. I could have missed them, but I don't think I did. And so it's all rather confusing as to exactly what's going on. Now, the cub's not here. This is just her. But those are old. Now, Andrew's just up ahead there, and he's had the same idea of me as I do. Maybe they're in between here and Parallel Road. So let's just have a quick talk to him, and we might be very lucky. Mandrani. Ingenile, uvonile mkonzo. Oh no, unganyane mangeni na mampimpana. Parallel Road and Kumang in Chu.
Okay.
Alright.
Enjoy.
Unfortunately, Andrew's got no more idea than we do. So you can see her tracks coming down here. That's why he's going that way, because he thinks she's killed all back there. Now that's not a bad thought, because of course we did hear a few Impala alarm calling. So she may have killed back there and be taking the cub that way. This is all wild postulation, of course. So who knows? Let's just drive slowly along here, exactly like Andrew did, and we might be lucky. Hello, Tasha. Nice question from you. You want to know if anybody does tracking before we come on drive or at night time? No, they don't. We do when we do the TV specials. We do often send out a tracking team, especially if we are driving only in the afternoon. So the last TV specials we did, we had trackers out all day long. But for the internet's drives, we don't, no. And at night, you know, in the morning, we go out just as it gets light, and it's almost impossible to try and track anything during the course of the day. Hang on a sec. There we go. It's almost impossible to track at night because you can't see any tracks. And so, yeah. I mean, you could drive around and hopefully see a few things. She's in here. She's in here somewhere. With her little baby moving north towards where there's a kill. I'm feeling me bones, Vim. So I think we'll just circle the block, basically, and maybe she'll pop out in front of us, and maybe she won't, but maybe we'll definitely find something else interesting to have a look at. We did see a giraffe in there while you were gone. I've told you that specifically because I know Vim doesn't like to film giraffe anymore, and now that I've told you, he'll have to if we see it again. Not so, Vim. Exactly. You may not have heard that sardonic comment. He says, I'll get you for that. There her tracks are again, still going this way. Yeah. I've no doubt this is what's happened. So we're going to go back in and around, and maybe we'll be lucky. I'm sure she's still moving to wherever she's made this kill. So we started our drive just down here, and we'll just follow on round. Hello, Gracie, aged just 8. You say, will I one day take Safari Gracie on my safari with me? So it's like you are on safari with me. Gracie, I will do that with pleasure. I have Safari Gracie sitting in my room, so she can certainly come on drive with us. They came past this very point in the road. Oh well, I think we're going to do one more large loop around here in a gentle fashion. We're not going to rush about anymore. This is where they crossed the road, right here. I'm going that away. And as Vim says, there were some impala here and they were very, very chilled out when we arrived this way. Hello, Macy. You say you've only been watching since January. Well, I think you're doing pretty well, Macy. Thank you for watching since January. I hope that you watch for many, many years to come. And you say, have we seen any cheetah cubs, A, and B, are they cuter than lion and leopard cubs? Well, here's some impala. I'm just going to switch off and see if we can't hear some more alarm calling impalas anywhere. Macy, we haven't seen any live, well, not while I've been working for Wild Earth, which has been just over a year. Have you seen cheetah cubs, Vim? No. So, Vim's been here now, what, 2 and a bit years? He's not talking to me, unfortunately. Anyway, Macy, no, because I've seen one female cheetah, and we've seen those two male cheetah quite frequently. So, yeah, we haven't seen any cubs yet. Are they cuter than leopard or lion cubs? No, I don't think they are. I think they're pretty cute, but a lion cub, I've got to tell you, wait till these Nkuhuma lionesses start producing their babies around us. I promise you now, there ain't nothing in the world cuter than a lion cub. And I know that a lion is nowhere close to being as cute as a leopard, or as good looking as a leopard, I don't think. But their cubs, well, I think that they're very, very special indeed. They make me very happy. We'll just ease our way along here. And while we do that, let's go back to the hyena den. And when we come across that giraffe, I shall beat VM into filming it. See you shortly.
So James has had no luck this afternoon with tracking. I'll have to go through perhaps some tracking basics this evening. Well, I think the two of us need to go through some tracking basics because I was unsuccessful this morning and James was unsuccessful this afternoon. But it happens like that at times. This female has not moved out of the den. She has just put her head down, very comfortable, very relaxed. And no sign of the cubs. But we are still very patient. So Kirsten in Denmark has asked me a question about the termite mound. Kirsten would like to know, how old do I think that termite mound is? So Kirsten, I don't know. It's a very difficult question. I'll tell you why. Firstly, I think what has happened here. Now, you need to remember termites, and especially in this area, termites feed on dead plant material, dead and decaying plant material. So they feed on the trees and the grass and so on. That's what termites feed on. They use a lot of the sand and to build their termite mound, but what they also use is their saliva and water, which they will get from the ground, the water table below. They excavate the sand, they mix it with their feces and saliva and a little bit of the water, and they mix it together and it forms this almost cement-like substance which they build up, and over many years it becomes harder and harder and becomes very, very hard. When it is still very new, it is quite soft and you can break it a little bit easily. But why I'm saying they feed on all that plant material is, look at all these trees growing out of the termite mound. So those trees would have grown after the termites had moved out. It is unlikely that those trees would have grown while the termites were still in there, because they feed on all that plant material. So in saying that, if you have a look at how big these trees are around the termite mound, they're quite old. So I'm guessing that a termite mound like that is probably 150, 200 years old, maybe, somewhere around there to get that size, but probably older. And like I said, it's very difficult. I'm not too sure how we can gauge the age of that termite mound, but I would guess it is very, very old. So Ellen has asked a question about termites and if they would ever repopulate old termite mounds. There is a possibility, Ellen, that they could come back and reuse an old termite mound. What most likely would happen is they may repopulate one side of the mound and begin building a new section to the termite mound. But often what happens is, and especially these big old termite mounds, you will get termites constantly using it for many, many, many years. Even if there are some that move off, you may get them coming back, because it will take forever or a very long time for these termites to build such a large mound. So it's not unlikely for them to use a termite mound again. They possibly could. But also what happens is, if there's not a lot of food in the area, they will try and find an area where the soil is a little bit softer and potentially there's more water around. Termites are very reliant on water and moisture. So they do try and look for areas where they can get to the groundwater table, and they use that water within the termite mound. But they're very interesting, interesting little creatures. And a termite mound like this is almost a living organism. All those termites within that mound create this well-oiled machine, almost, if I can put it like that. They regulate the temperature in there. Every termite has a specific role. You have worker termites, you have soldier termites, and you have the queen. Now, all the termites are generally about that size. Very, very small, so about that size. But the queen termite is about this big, very, very large, and her job is purely to lay eggs. All she does is lay eggs constantly, and the workers will transport those eggs and incubate them. And once they hatch, each termite has been programmed almost for a specific role in that termite mound. The female will control the amount of hormones I've hit a blank and I'll get back to that, but she controls the hormones which each termite will get, and that will determine whether or not they become worker termites or soldier termites. And she will know, there's chemical communication between these termites. She will know what the termite mound needs, which is incredible. It's fascinating if you think about it. And then once the numbers just continually increase, she will lay thousands of eggs a day, and they will all have a specific role. The workers will bring food to the termite mound, and the soldiers will purely protect the termite mound. Now, how they regulate the temperature is by all the movement, they use thermoregulation, so they create their own heat within their termite mound. But what happens is, and the way they build it, is they've got a chimney system which works throughout their termite mound to circulate the air, and that causes it to cool or warm up. And depending on the outside temperature, they will either open the termite mound, allow air to escape and come in, or close it up and allow the air to stay warm. They're regulated at about 32 to 34 degrees Celsius. It's amazing, absolutely amazing. Often in winter, especially in winter, There's certain times and cool summer mornings, if you're lucky, if you go and find an open termite mound, a fresh termite mound, and you stick your hand over it, you can feel the warmth coming out of there as the air is circulated through. It's wonderful. I think our beautiful hyena mother is fast asleep and relaxing. Cross over to James and see what he's up to.
Hello again, everybody. We are just sitting under the boughs, leafy boughs of a brown ivory tree, bohemia discolor, listening, hoping to hear the sound of crunch, crunch, crunch. But there is no such sound. So I'm afraid this leopard has bamboozled us, in the words of Wim Durenbrach. So that's it, I'm afraid. Well, we'll just quickly, we'll drive along this road, we'll see if she pops out. But I'm afraid, I think she's beaten us good and proper. Somewhere in here, she and her little cubby are having supper, which is good news. I hope she manages to hoist it into a tree. She's rather close to where our hyena clan's boundary meets the Arethusa hyena clan's boundary. And that's not really good for a leopardess that doesn't take to lifting her kills into trees very well. Anyway, I don't believe that the youngsters were at the termite mound, the hyenas, the little hyenas, so I'm sorry about that. I think they're probably still just a little bit young to be spending a lot of time outside. Also, I've been fascinated there because she's been on her own for a long time, and I think that most of the rest of the clan are still lurking about inside Simbambili at their little secondary den that they created there a little while back. Now, Viam, I'm warning you in advance. The giraffe was around here. Don't pretend if you don't spot it.
Yes, I saw it.
Did you lie? You hear that, everybody? He said he saw the tracks of it leaving. He's talking nonsense. It was just in here. It was that same giraffe with that squaff left horn. She did not go to Simbambili. I don't know if you saw much of the western horizon from the hyena den, probably not a lot, but it was a spectacular sunset, I must say. Very beautiful indeed. You know what? Shadow could easily be on Simbambili. We are now at the northern boundary of our traversing area, so we're going to head back towards Juma and see what we can see there. At least the elephants have been around for us most of the day. Right, there it is. I'll try and get you a look at the western horizon because it is quite impressive and it looks a little bit like there's a fire. But I don't know what would be burning unless it's a forestry fire, which it could be. That's way down south of us in the mountains. Ah, Kevin, very nice question from you. Why don't we use planes or drones or choppers to find the animals? Kevin, we've done it before, and certainly there is the thought that we should be doing it, especially for nighttime, and we'd put a thermal imaging drone up. We actually did it one night. We did an experiment with a thermal imaging drone, and we had some pretty good results. So certainly that is on the cards. But, I mean, it does take a little bit away from the romance of this tracking sort of thing. But yeah, we're definitely going to do it, and we have done it in the past. And we've just yesterday managed to launch our first fixed-wing drone. And, I mean, I say we, I mean entirely our engineer Connor managed to build and launch a fixed-wing drone. And that will be used for probably for tracking and probably for thermal imaging one day, which will be great. So we will certainly do that.
You can't get too close though, and you've got to have a fairly substantial camera. Sorry, excuse my not looking at you. I'm just checking if her tracks are come this far north, because they start not far from here. So Kevin, you've got to have a really fancy camera in order to be able to spot anything from a drone, and or you've got to be quite low down. But the drones make quite a noise, and so if you're going to fly them very low down, you frighten the animals. But we had an amazing sequence, come to think of it. I remember now, I'm giving up on this leopard, I'm afraid. I don't know where she's gone. She's somewhere in here, but that could mean anything. So let's go back onto Juma. I nearly indicated there, like Byron. Kevin, we had an amazing sighting with Brent, went in on foot. He found, I think it was Shadow actually, he found her. He pulled out, and then Jamie went in there, but the leopard was moving. And so Andrew flew the drone in over the top, and while Jamie was finding it, because it was quite an open area, and the drone sat above them and guided Jamie into the sighting. It was the most wonderful thing to see and watch, and so it absolutely is an option going forward. But we have to make sure that we're not having any effect on the animals, and we also, it's not easy to get permission to fly drones around national park areas because of the rhino poaching problem that there is. And so, you know, you can't just, not everyone can just throw a drone into the air and fly about the place. So it eventually will happen. Let's go up and look at Sandy Patch and see if there aren't some jackals there. Might want to say hello to us, even though Shadow and her baby did not. Very distressing, isn't it, VM? Yes. Hello, Brian in Wyoming. I'm not sure I've spoken to you before. It's lovely to have you with us. You want to know the difference between a jackal and a hyena? Well, Brian, they're from totally different families. The jackal is from the family Canidae, that's the dog family. The hyenas are from the family Hyenidae, and that's a totally different family. And it's actually from a different superfamily that is much more closely related to the cats than it is to the dogs. So they are totally unrelated. And then from a, they're as related to each other as, a mongoose and a dog are. I'm just going to quickly talk to Lex, who's hailing me on the radio. Go ahead. Yes. Copy that, I'm on my way. 2 minutes away. Karula and two cubs at Vuyatela Dam. Here we go. Well done, Lex. That's not bad. We're only about 2 minutes from there, everybody. Hold on tight, everybody. The radio is now going to go ballistic, of course. I'm just going to turn this radio down a bit. Now, we're not going to view them with lights on, so I've got to get there really quickly. Sorry, Kirsten, you'll have to say that again. Yes, we're on our way. Apparently the elephants are chasing Karula at the dam. We're not far from there, everybody. Drive very quickly. Now, the dam cam is on. You can see exactly what's going on there, I think. Quite extraordinary. We're just trying to get control of it, so if the Zoomie is watching, just go as wide out as possible. Well done, Zoomie. Well done. So you're watching there. We'll be there hopefully in the next minute. This is so exciting. And just to reiterate, we won't be putting a light on her, so we do need to get there as soon as possible to use as much of the natural light as we can. And you can see the one cub in the bush apparently. It's unbelievable stuff. Hold on, Vimpy. I can't believe this. Kirsten, what's happening there? So the little cub apparently is behind the bush. And you, and you can see a cub in the bush. I'm amazed. I'm narrating this, of course, from now 30 seconds out. Now you can see the mother. I'll be... Oh, they're running across the dam. Well done, Zumi. You're doing a sterling, sterling job of bringing this to us. Oh, boy, this is amazing. The cubs are with Karula. This is incredible stuff. Right. Here. See the elephants. I can see a water buck. You can see the elephants. This is unbelievable stuff. Now, Kirsten, where did the leopard go? Can you see it? What? This is too wonderful. That, look at them. There the little things are. Oh, wow. The Queen, George, and Charlotte. Wandering across the open, and there were impalas shouting in alarm earlier today from round here. Let's try and catch up with them for a little bit. Can we get down here, Vimpy, or do you think we'll create a problem? There is a spot, hey? I think it's here. Yeah, we're okay down here. Isn't that special, everyone? What an unbelievable sighting. Bit below the tower. There she is. We're going to just keep our distance. I wonder if she see what we there go. They're just jogging through the drainage line there. I wonder if she's not going to pop out onto Mvubu Road. Just find out where Byron is. You can hear the birds' alarm calling. There she is. She's just there. Nice view here. Just turn the radio up so that Lex can get hold of me.
How exciting is that? You got to see Karula and her cubs. I'm sure we'll be back with James shortly. But just like I said, it's too soon to panic. And I thought he'd get lucky, and he did. Not quite the leopard he was looking for, but a leopard is a leopard. So that is very exciting. I haven't seen her yet, so hopefully I'll be able to catch some of the footage later. We left the hyena den site. There was no cub activity at all. The female just lay at the entrance to the den. She didn't move any further. And it's getting a bit dark, so we didn't want to disturb them if they are still around inside, which I'm sure they are. We passed some elephant, but that was while you were watching Karula and her cubs. They just moved off into the thicket. But that is very exciting. I'm so glad that you got to see them. Now the multitasking begins. I think the signal's back with James. Go and see if Karula's still around.
They're still here, everybody. There they go. Lex, they've just crossed Mvubu, going northeast into the block. She's got a kill in here, everybody. I'm sure she has. Look. Sorry, I have to keep my distance, I'm afraid, everyone. There you are. You can see them now. They're jogging forward. I just have to keep my distance because we don't want to make a big crushing noise. Thank you.
In fact, let's just... you can hear the...
Look, on the tree, Karula on the tree. Jumped off the tree.
Sorry, I saw that a bit late, everyone.
That was wonderful. I wonder why she leapt up there. Even as a granny, she's very playful. I'm sure there's going to be a kill here somewhere.
I can hear the alarm calling Franklin's. See, we don't want to make too much noise through here. I'm just going to crush this one, everybody. Hold on. There we go. But at least we've seen them. They're safe, they're happy. And with any luck, we'll find her on a kill in here. There they are in front of us. I think, no, it's not. Saw something. I can see her. She's in here somewhere. There. There's a look. There they are. Right there. Oh, that's wonderful. Oh, wow. Liam, don't you feel like we deserve this?
Yes. We hoped for one cup and got two.
We hoped for one and got two. Oh, wow. Is that George or Charlotte? Let's look. The eyes, everybody, is how you tell. Georgie boy's got light eyes. Charlotte, dark. That is George. Hello, Georgie. Nice to see you, fellow. This is just wonderful. My life is complete. I've got to tell you, it is unbelievable how I feel after a sighting like this. I wonder if she doesn't have a kill in here, under these thickets, perhaps. Yeah, Christy, I agree with you completely. You say you can't believe how fast they've grown up. I agree completely. I'm astounded by how fast they've grown up. Oh, look. Hello, little George. Going to say hi to his mum. Oh, wow. Doug, you're in Connecticut and you say, is this area not too far from where they were born? Doug, it is close. It is quite close to where they were born. They were born just to the east of this in the drainage line, in the Mawati drainage. Probably about, I don't know, about half a mile maybe. So not far as the crow flies. It feels quite far, though, when you drive around on the road. But it isn't too far. Can you see the cubs, Wimpy?
Yeah.
I'm going to... I wonder if there isn't kill in the bush here. Let's just sneak a little bit forward. And look under the bush here. And see if there isn't something here. That the clever queen has left for her little ones to sup upon. Now, you see, it's getting very dark now. I'm just going to ease around the side here. Go ahead. Yeah, Lex can see the kill. Yeah, I'll copy that. I'm just going to move around to where Lex is. And you can see, can you believe that those elephants took offense at a little leopard like this with their little cubs? And it amazes me how amazingly upset elephants get by predators. Very noisy. I think we may have picked up a fairly large tree. The universe doth... Ooh. Sorry, there's a little one right in front of us here. Everyone, it's too dark now for me to move around the sighting, so we're just going to stop right here, and when we move, we'll reverse out. I hardly saw her. I can hear one of them feeding. Wimpy, it's just the one there, hey?
You want to see?
Okay, I'm going to ease forward just because we have to get out of here. And then we will come back into this area tomorrow morning, everyone. Yeah, I can see the other one now as well. All right, let's go across to Byron. I'm going to try and get out of this situation, I think, and then if we get one last look, we'll have it, but let's go back to Byron for now.
Great, so you got to see Karula and her cubs. That's fantastic. I'm really happy to hear that. James was moving out of that area now, and we've got to remember they're still young cubs. We've got to be very sensitive around them. With the vehicles moving around and having the spotlights on, you can often disturb them quite a bit and maybe attract animals like hyenas, which we don't want. So we do still need to be very sensitive with those animals, but so wonderful that you were able to see them. The good thing is, we've got a confirmed sighting of them very close to camp, so potentially tomorrow morning we might be able to follow up around that area. Maybe James and I will have to track together. Sorry, just a little bit of a hold here. Ooh. Hold on, Brian. Trying to see if I can't spot any owls around. So Sean from Secunda has asked, are there any fruit bats around here? Sean, I haven't heard any. I'm not too sure, but the fruit bats have got that very high-pitched sound that they make at night, high-pitched chirp or whistle. I haven't heard any. I'm not too sure if we do get any fruit bats in this area. We do get epauletted bats around and other species, but no fruit bats. I think they prefer warmer areas where there are a lot of insects, so high rainfall. Tend to get a lot of fruit bats. So down at the coast, Cape Town, down along the western or the eastern coast, Durban, KwaZulu-Natal, you get a lot of fruit bats down there. They prefer that type of climate. We need to try to find a bush baby tonight. James found one the other night. I'm very jealous. I haven't found you one yet. So let's hope. I'm scanning very carefully. Beautiful evening. It's not too cold. We were worried. We thought the temperature was going to drop quite a bit because of that wind we had earlier. But it seems very pleasant. Also not driving too fast. We're just really calmly driving through the bush and hoping to spot any little movement from nocturnal wildlife. Jennet or a civet, owls, bush babies, maybe a... Oh, hang on. Do I see something through there? No. There's some bats flying around. But let me just turn the lights off for a second. I wonder how this would affect our shot. But look at that silhouette and the color in the sky at the moment. Another tough day in Africa. Makes it so worth it. Look at that, just amazing. You know, we are always in search of wildlife and interesting things to see, but taking the time just to appreciate a sunset like this is also very important. It's soothing, I think, and I think it's good for the soul. You know, they say Africa has a heartbeat, and I think for a lot of foreigners that travel out here, when they experience it, and they get this feeling when they arrive in Africa, and I think it sticks with you forever. I know it's definitely the case for me. It's in my blood. There are the bats. See a bat flying through the screen. Wonderful. Isn't that fantastic? So Jen from San Diego has asked a question about the bush babies. She would like to know, why do the bush baby eyes glow so red in the torchlight? So Gwen, one of the reasons is the number of, and from my understanding, the number of rods and cones in a lot of these animals depend on how good their eyes, depends on how, or determines rather, how good their eyesight is in the evenings. Now those are nocturnal animals, so they've got very large eyes to be able to allow a lot of light in so that they can see very, very well. Now, I think it's purely because they've got those very large eyes. A lot of predators' eyes are also very large, and as the light reflects it, it reflects the probably the pupil in that of the eye, and you get this red coloration. So I'm sure it's got to do with the amount of rods and cones and the color reflected back out of the eye. But the reason for that is because they have nocturnal eyesight. They've got very, very good eyesight, much better than ours at night. James has got a genet, another nocturnal animal.
Guess what that is, everybody? I thought it was a bush baby until VM, the great cameraman naturalist, pointed out to me that it is in fact a genet. A lesser-spotted genet peeping at us from the top of a tree, which is very, very nice indeed. We left those leopards. We can definitely hear one of them feeding, and so we're not going to put lights on there, and hopefully they'll still be there in the morning. That would be great. So that probably is a small-spotted genet. You get two kinds. You get the large-spotted and small-spotted. As far as I remember it, you know, it's been so long I've had to talk about it, that I've had to talk about a genet. But I'm 90% sure that's a small spotted. And what it'll be doing is crawling along the branches very stealthily, looking for nesting birds, perhaps the odd reptile, and if it's very lucky, I guess a scorpion or two. Very Catholic diet. And they look, you can see it looks a little bit like a cat. But it isn't a cat. It's much more closely related to a mongoose, and even more closely related to a civet. And they're from the same family as the civet. You had a lovely name. The family's called the Viviridae. And although very beautiful, they had the disconcerting habit of marking territory with a distinctly smelly anal gland. Here comes Byron Sarau. I can hear his vehicle. Baron. Baron, if you shine your light to where I'm shining mine, I want him to just see if he can't get an angle on it. Baron, stop your car. If you shine your light where I'm shining,
You might catch the genet at a different angle from the one I've got it. Up top? In the tree. Oh, no. Maybe you were unsighted. I thought you might get it from where you were. Okay, sorry about that. You'll just have to sit there and wait. Thank you. It's more than I managed to find myself. You heard that, did you, everybody? He says he managed to find me. Well, that's a relief. So let's just see if it comes out. I know this isn't a great shot. In fact, the camera that Byron's got would probably be much better for the sighting. Yeah, Byron, just there. That's yeah, up above where you're shining the light there. Yeah, you're on it. Just look around there. Your camera will be better than ours. Apparently the camera's on me. Thank you for that. I just want you to try and... I just want you to see if he doesn't come out. Because they're very special things, and they look like cats, but they're very long. Until you look closely at them, they've got these long bodies with these incredibly thick, long tails. But much like the cats, they are infinitely patient. And you know, they're still found in cities. The last time I saw a genet before I moved back to the bush, I saw one in a suburb called Dunkeld in Johannesburg. And it is the middle of the urban jungle. Lots of trees around there, but you find these lesser spotted genets. They're highly variable and highly adaptable, able to live just about anywhere. We could try and sneak a bit closer. What do you think, Vim?
I think it would be cool.
Okay, let me try and sneak a little bit closer, everyone. Brian, at least Byron, is looking into the top of the tree there. Any luck, he'll be able to pick it up from where he is. I'm just going to move straight closer to it. Baron is just in front of me here. See it, VMP? That's the best we're going to do, everyone. It's cool, eh? There, now you can see the detail on its face. You can see it's cat-like until you look very, very closely. Baron, if you ease down here with that camera, you might get a better view. If you just sort of park right next to us. Let's get Byron in here with that other camera. And just, you might, because it looks so cat-like until you get up close. And then you can see it is not quite there. Oh, that's wonderful. You got it there. In the, you can see where that little fork is where I'm shining. The fork in the tree where I'm shining. Right, we'll let Byron try and find it there. That's wonderful. Just having a little snooze. Let me put this light on. There, I'm going to take the spotlight off. That's much better. Can you see it?
Okay, yes.
Okay. Oh, that's wonderful. Look at it. And you can imagine how many creatures there must be lurking in the branches of all these trees here. And how many we don't see. There you've got Byron's picture, which is obviously a little bit closer than ours. Brian on the super zoom. And you can see, I'm sure, from its face there, that although it looks cat-like, once you get in close, you can see those white marks, and it looks much more closely related almost to a raccoon, I suppose. I remember being struck by that the first time I saw a close-up of a genet, thinking how uncat-like its face looks when you actually get a hard look at it. It's just gone to sleep there. That's so cool. Everyone, I think I've seen two of these maybe in the year that I've been here. We find their tracks all over the place, much like we do with the civets. But these chaps are all over the place. I can see, just opened its eyes to look at Byron and Brian. He's most impressed by them, of course. Fine fellows they are.
can see its face, a long nose for smelling out things. Now you can see our picture, and you can see it's very carefully just stuck itself into the fork of those two little trees, or the one tree, two branches. Very sleepy. And it can hear somebody's having a drink not too far from here. I think they're on safari, and you can see the ears twitching, listening to the voices in the night, knowing that almost certainly they won't be able to spot it up here. Right, let's head across to Byron and get his impression on the state of affairs here. Byron, over to you.
Thank you, James. Well spotted. I'm very impressed. And how beautiful is that, just to see that little genet hiding and resting in that tree. Look at those ears working. Very, very incredible, incredibly sensitive hearing. They can hear insects moving through the grass when they are looking for food. Look at those beautiful big eyes. See, also because it is a nocturnal animal, it's got those large eyes. You can see a little bit of the reflection in its eyes. I don't want to shine directly on it because the bright light can affect their eyesight a little bit, but we're just off of it and it's very relaxed and settled in there nicely. This is wonderful. Beautiful, beautiful little animal. Can hear Scops owls calling in the distance. A great evening. That sunset was incredible. I hear a few of the viewers are saying it looks like a fox. It does, almost to an extent, I suppose. That little face, the pointed nose. There you can see the markings on the body clearly. Look at those spots moving down the side of the body. Beautiful little animal. And I suppose it does look fox-like, cat-like. It's very, got a few characteristics of those animals. Look at those beautiful markings on the tail. You can see the stripes, the black and the brown stripes over the tail. Oh, there it goes. And they are nocturnal, so James possibly found this just before it began to wake up. I'm not too sure if it was moving. James, was it moving? It was mobile, so possibly just resting a little bit, and then we'll slowly start moving around a lot more and scavenging for food. Not scavenging, foraging for food, rather. When James and I used to work together, when James used to train me,